Hello scholars, you would have seen the space around you is filled with essential furniture. Today, I am going to give you some information on furniture styles. All the different pieces of furniture we have in our homes today have evolved from four needs of man: a place to sit down, a place to lie down, a place at which to work or eat, and a place in which to store belongings. The first chair was probably hewn from a tree stump. The first table may have been a slab of rock. The first bed may have been a sort of hammock or a pile of leaves. The first chest may have been a hole in the ground or later a crude box. From the first chair have come ladder back chair, windsor, rocker, club lounge, wing button back, and many other styles. The sofa, settee and love seat originated from the idea of a chair. From the first crude beds have come couches, bed sofas and beds of all sizes and styles. From the first table, creative man has designed dining, card, tea, coffee, drop leaf, pembroke, console and dozens of other styles of tables. From man's first box or treasure chest have come all kinds of chests. This lesson is developed with the following objectives: to make you understand the salient features of traditional furniture, to present few information on furniture used in India, to know about contemporary and modern furniture. Let us now see about the different styles of furniture in detail now. Traditional furniture. The first one is Jacobean period or traditional furniture. The Jacobean period, running from 1603 to 1688, was influenced primarily by the events of the preceding reign, that of Queen Elizabeth. The Jacobean period covers the reigns of James I, Charles I, Cromwell, Charles II, and James II. Oak was the most popular furniture wood between 1500 to 1680. Furniture forms were rectangular and massive. Moldings in geometric forms and carving in strap work, in scrolls, in acorn leaves, or in geometric designs were the chief embellishments. The bulbous or melon leg of the Elizabethan period continued for a while, but later gave way to the more slender baluster, Flemish scroll and spiral twist legs. The spiral turning was Portuguese influence. Chairs were improved a bit in comfort and sometimes had padded seats and backs upholstered with tapestry and decorated with fringe. Caning in the seats and backs produced lighter and little more graceful chairs. The wing-back chair appeared during the reign of Charles II and was first known as sleeping chair. Chests included the Dover chest, bread and cheese cupboard, and later the chest on chest. Drawer pulls usually took the form of acorns. The gate leg and the long refractory tables are characteristics of the period. William and Mary period. When the Glorious Revolution of 1688 forced James II to flee from England, his daughter Mary and her husband William of Orange were invited to become joint rulers. They ruled from 1689 to 1702. The new rulers introduced a more leisurely and a simpler way of living. Queen Mary was a home-loving queen, and the cabinet makers of the court created furniture for her needs. She had fine collection of Chinese porcelain, and her cabinet makers designed cupboards to display this art. The cupboards were decorated with a canopy or a hood, a form which has become typical of William and Mary secretaries, chairs and settees. From the china cupboard developed the first highboy or chest of drawers set on a table. The table had a curved apron or support which carried down to the leg. Chairs became more comfortable and graceful. Typical legs were cup-turned and trumpet and the octagonal tapered. A stretcher was used between the legs of tables, chairs, settees and cupboards. The bun foot, like a flattened ball, was most common, but the Spanish scroll and the ball and claw were also used. The principal surface decoration on all William and Mary pieces was either veneering or marquetry. Fine needle point and lovely tapestries were used for upholstery. William and Mary furniture may be combined with late Jacobean or Queen Anne period. Now we'll see about Queen Anne period. When William died, Anne, Mary's youngest sister, became the queen. The period, which ran from 1702 to 1714, was marked by general prosperity and elaborate entertaining, yet the taste of Queen Anne were very simple. Except for the characteristic shell carving, furniture depended upon its lines and the grain of the wood used for beauty. Finishes included lacquering, marquetry and veneering. The Queen Anne style depended upon curves rather than the straight lines of William and Mary style, and no stretchers were used between legs. Both the William and Mary and the Queen Anne periods in the furniture became known as the Age of Walnut. However, near the end of Anne's rule, mahogany was becoming popular. Chairs of the Queen Anne period were graceful and often armless to accommodate the ladies' full skirts. The backs of chairs were slightly curved at shoulder height, and a splat down the center of the back was introduced. The fiddle back and the oval back chairs were the characteristic shapes. Armchairs were characterized by their continuous arms. The curved or gabriole leg, which had a conventionalized knee and ankle form, was typical. The knee was usually decorated with shell carving. The leg terminated in a club or a ball and claw foot. The settee was a combination of two or more chairs. Fine needle point and tapestries were used for upholstery. Card playing and tea drinking were favorite pastimes, so naturally a variety of small tables were designed. Drop leaf tables increased in popularity, as well as tilt top tables with plain tops or raised and carved pie crust edges. High boys cabinets and china cupboards had carved broken curved tops or broken pediments. Washstands, wick stands and tall clocks had characteristics similar to those of other cabinets. Graceful brass drawer pulls and key plates enhance the beauty of the various types of chests. Drawer handles were frequently pear-shaped. Chippendale furniture. With the death of Queen Anne, the court no longer dictated furniture styles. Furniture designs began to take the name of the designer. However, the period from 1720 to 1810, marked by the reigns of George I, II and III, and it is referred to generally as the Georgian period. It became known as the Golden Age of Furniture, and mahogany became the principal wood. Of the four names connected with furniture during the period, Chippendale, Adam, Hepplewhite and Sheraton, that of Chippendale is probably the most famous. Chippendale, who lived from 1718 to 1779, was the son of a cabinet maker and was trained from boyhood in the craft. During Chippendale's time, there was a revival of interest in Gothic architecture. So, Chippendale naturally took advantage of it, particularly in his chair designs. Some of the Gothic designs with arched tops, pierced bracts, and straight square legs were good, but others in the Chippendale attempted to duplicate stone carving in wood were not successful. As trade with China increased, there was a strong Chinese influence in Chippendale designs. The chair backs became more nearly square and the entire back was filled in with Chinese fret or lattice work. Legs were square and straight, or resembled several bamboo rods bound together. Perhaps the three most popular Chippendale chairs reproduced today are the pierced ladder back chair and ribbon back chair, and the wing back upholstered chair called the 40 wings chair. All the Chippendale chairs had broad fronts and narrow backs. Chippendale sofas and settees were of two styles: the all wood back combining two or three chair backs, and the upholstered serpentine back with rolled arms, which is popular today. Legs were either gabriole or straight. Upholstery materials included fine leather, needlepoint, tapestry, embroidery and damask. Chippendale tables where Queen Anne in form tilt top types with a center pedestal and three leg console or wall types supported by curved and carved supports. Drop leaf types and tea and coffee style also included. The intricate carving or interesting lacquer made them distinctly Chippendale. Cupboards, straight or brick fronted cabinets and lattice glass doors with symmetrical swan neck decoration were common. The doors were usually topped with a carved broken curve pediment and a centered finial urn or eagle. The beautiful brass hardware added a distinctive finish to all cabinet pieces. Chippendale mirrors, either plain or elaborately carved, and grandfather clocks are among other cherished pieces of Chippendale design. Adam furniture. The Adam period from 1762 to 1794 is often called the neoclassic period. The Adam brothers, of whom Robert is the best known, were primarily architects concerned with harmonizing exterior and interior decoration. Catering only to the wealthy, they designed all the decoration of a house, including the furniture, although they actually made very little furniture. The Adam brothers discouraged the vogue of wood panel walls and instead they used plaster in delicate tones to serve as a suitable background for the lovely mahogany furniture. They used raised plaster moldings in classic designs around ceilings or borders and as panels. Artists were employed to paint appropriate settings within the moldings. The brothers also used wedgewood plaques for ornamentation over doorways and fireplaces. Their mantles were especially beautiful and were ornamented with classic borders and medallions. Favorite motifs were festoons, frets, honeysuckle designs, swags, patrae, or flat circular disc-like ornaments, wheatears, husks, urns, and rosettes. Hepplewhite furniture. The date of Hepplewhite's birth is not known, though he died in 1786. His furniture is often criticized because of its very delicate construction. Drop leaf was one of Hepplewhite's favorite tables. He made many card, end, console, coffee, dining, and side tables. His chairs were small, delicate, and unusually graceful. The most familiar backs were the shield and the camel back. Within the backs, he designed urns, prints of whale's plumes and wheatears. Other backs included oval and interlacing heart and the wheel. The legs were always straight, slender and tapering and were either square or round. The chairs often had upholstered seats. The sofas and settees had backs that repeated the chair backs. Hepplewhite's other pieces included dressing tables with heart-shaped mirrors, roll-top writing desk, washstands, secretaries, clock cases, and four-poster beds with light, delicate posts. Hepplewhite designed in mahogany and in satin wood. Hardware on Hepplewhite pieces is inconspicuous. Occasionally, he employed artists to decorate his pieces with painting. Frequently, he used vinies and inlays. His favorite upholstery fabrics were delicate brocades, horsehairs, silks and satins with delicate flowers and stripes. Sheraton furniture. Sheraton, who lived from 1751 to 1806, was a preacher, teacher, artist and author. He had a particular fascination for secret compartments and trick springs and was the first designer to introduce concealed drawers, panels and compartments. This feature appealed to the ladies. Sheraton chairs were delicate in line. Chair backs were characteristically rectangular in shape with vertical balusters, latticed and lower cross rails. Chair arms were delicate and continuous with front legs and the back. Chair legs were straight and tapering, terminating in a spoon and spade foot. Sheraton preferred inlay, painting and multicolored marquetry. He often bleached and dyed woods for just the right effect in marquetry. His favorite motifs were swags, festoons, urns, panels and lattice work. He used mahogany, satin wood, and tulip wood. If pieces demanded upholstery, he used delicate fabrics and colors. In addition to his chair designs, Sheraton is well known for his Pembroke tables, his screens on poles with a tripod base, his bookcases with lattice door, and his van neck pediments. Victorian furniture. The Victorian period extends from 1837 to 1901. Queen Victoria herself had little interest in art. Occasionally, chairs, tables, and love seats had a homey charm that counteracted a rather uncomfortable style. The principal woods were black walnut, mahogany, and rosewood. Carved decoration took the form of roses, buds, and fruit. Wood pulls in the shape of carved fruits or pear drops replaced metal. Painting and mother of pearl were also popular decorations. Chair backs were usually spoon-shaped, and the popular rose carving decorated chair and love seat frames. The legs were a slender cabriole type. Many chairs were tufted and upholstered with plush or horsehair. Other popular pieces were drum-shaped tables, terraced corner tables, whatnot stands, candle stands, and drop-leaf tables with center pedestals. French provincial furniture. The furniture produced during the Louis XIV, Louis XV, and Louis XVI. The lines of Louis XV and Louis XVI furniture were simplified and reproduced in local woods such as pear, cherry, apple, oak, walnut, ash, and elm. Present day, chairs upholstered or made of solid wood have rather low graceful backs and straight tapering or curved cabriole legs. Gingham or homespun material are used extensively for upholstery and pads. The large wardrobe called armoire, which was used as a substitute for a closet, is especially characteristic of the style. Hanging shelves for pottery, glass, and brass was also associated with the style. Early pieces include trestle tables and four-poster beds with valances and draperies. Early American styles. Our early colonists brought little furniture from them. They constructed rather crude furniture during the first half of the 17th century. As William and Mary furniture became popular abroad, pieces were gradually imported and copied. Later, Queen Anne style extended their influence to a more marked degree, and the Dutch influence was felt especially in the later part of the 18th century. Little decoration except shallow carving was used. Stain and wax were the only furniture finishes until a later date, where veneering and shellacking were introduced. Chairs were sometimes paneled to relieve the flatness of broad areas. Important tables were the butterfly with supports shaped like butterfly wings for the drop leaves, the gate legs with legs which could be folded back when the leaves were dropped, and the trestle with trestle-like legs supporting a stationary top. Hinge top chest, corner boards, hardly chest with sunflower carving, high boys, low boys, settees, candle stands, and slant top desk, four-poster and an overall canopy or a covering over the head only, shaving stands, and mirrors were used during this period. American Georgian or 18th century furniture. The American Georgian period from 1725 to 1780 parallels the 18th century or Georgian period in England and the Louis XV period in France. Style and beauty were important consideration in selecting furniture, and many new pieces such as tea tables, china cabinets, and card tables and the like were introduced. Queen Anne's splat or fiddleback chairs, tilt-top pie crust tables, knee-hole desk and tables, slant-top desk, tall case clocks, banjo clocks, and decoratively framed mirrors were beveled glass were other popular items. Mahogany was the principal wood used, and a lacquer-like finish suggestive of Chinese lacquer came into vogue. Duncan Hyphy furniture. The federal period from 1780 to 1830 coincides with the late Georgian and Regency period in England and the Louis XVI. Hyphy did not originate completely new styles. He merely interpreted the styles of Sheraton and the French Empire periods. Duncan Hyphy worked with mahogany, cherry, maple and fruit woods, and his table, chairs and sofas are some of the most beautiful examples of American furniture. His favorite motifs were the lyre and acanthus. He also used shells, bound arrows, pineapples, birds, lion heads and eagles. Carving was a favorite means of decoration on table and sofa legs, and metal or ormolu mounds usually enclosed the drawers were often veneered with beautifully grained mahogany in a V-shaped pattern. Hardware was used extensively in the form of metal or ormolu tips on legs, brass, eagle, finials on desk and mirrors, and metal lion mask and rings are drawer pulls. Toward the end of the period, china and glass knobs replaced the brass pulls. So far, I have been talking to you about the styles in furniture followed in Western countries. Now, I would like to enlighten you briefly on furniture styles adopted in India. Now, we'll see the development of furniture in India. The development of furniture in India cannot be classified according to periods as such because there are no specific records. Although a distinct classification is not possible, broadly we can divide the development of furniture stages in India into following major categories. The home of Nagarika or citizen of ancient India, the period of Indo-Aryan fusion, the golden age, decoration in medieval India, the influence of Western style. The home of Nagarika. This is a prehistoric period dating back to 2500 to 1700 BC. The Indian homes in these early civilizations were not full of furniture. A mattress on floor was probably used for sleeping and rugged or a carpet was used for sitting purpose. It was also found that a small and low stool was used for keeping toilet articles. The period of Indo-Aryan fusion. The common man used a mat, a carpet or a skin as an asana. These special seats were exquisitely carved or inlaid with precious metals and stones. Gold, silver, copper and other such metals were used, and precious and semi-precious stones were also used. These seats were obviously meant for important people like king, princes and aristocrats. The Golden Age. The Golden Age in Indian history in this particular context is taken from 6th century BC to 7th century AD. The high seats with back and a footstool to rest the feet are seen in frescoes of Ajanta and are a proof that high seats like chairs were in vogue even then. The love seats, that is seats for two people, and some form of writing tables were also seen. The frescoes of Ajanta also show furniture with lathe turned round wooden legs. The medieval period. The medieval period reflected sophisticated style of living and well-kept homes. The furniture and furnishing show influence of Persian characteristics of Mughal art. A divan or takht was the predominant feature of living room. Chowkis or low stools are also seen in these paintings. The seats were made with metal and ivory inlay or lacquer painted. It is said that the divan was used for twin purpose, that is sleeping and sitting during Mughal period. Charpai was used by common man for similar purposes. The furniture therefore in late medieval period shows a marked influence of West, but at the same time the East and its influence on the Western designs, which led to a new style Indo-European. Western influence on Indian furniture. Domestic furniture, in the sense in which it was known as European countries, was not traditional in India before 16th century. The European traders started exporting Western prototypes for making suitable furniture for their homes. The Indian craftsmen adopted the foreign decorations. A new style thus emerged, which could be learned or termed as Indo-European. European influence. The Indo-European style emerged with the growth of British power in 18th century, English influence being predominant. The entire sets of furniture were made in ivory, adopting styles of Chippendale and Sheraton. The furniture was being made not only for European buyers, but also for native rulers who started favoring European style of living. Excellent carved shisham furniture, which was seen in areas where the Europeans settled, that is in Goa, Calcutta, Bombay, Surat, Madras or Ahmedabad. This type of furniture became popular in 18th and 19th century because it had combined features of Western and Indian designs. The furniture such as chairs, beds, tables, settees, benches, chest of drawers and stools were being produced with increasing influence of French style. Contemporary style. The contemporary furniture represent a fresh approach to the use of space and feature clear cut lines, functional and easily maintained surfaces. The characteristics of contemporary is built-in furniture with separate units that may be grouped or stacked to appear built-in. These styles depend on line, form, grain of wood and texture of fabric more than upon carving or other embellishment. Contemporary furniture styles are low and lines are only moderately curved. Metals, glass, wood, marble, caning, bamboo and plastics may be used singly or in combination. Modern furniture. Modern furniture refers to furniture produced from late 20th century through the present, that is influenced by modernism. The modern furniture have straight lines, geometric forms, smooth lightweight materials, polished metals and sometimes with informal shapes with unusual curves. They do not have additional decoration or ornaments. They have flat surface fabric material with no pattern. They use technically innovative materials such as many forms of glass, metal, chrome, stainless steel, aluminium, molded plastic and engineering wood. Neutral color tones were mostly used. The furniture is generally sleek, elegant and simple. They are generally manufactured in large scale in factories. Hand-carved ornamentation is replaced by machine carving. The furniture plays a dual role of being functional as well as decorative pieces or serves more than one purpose. Functionality is one of the important characteristics of modern furniture. Use of different materials, at least two materials, is common. Standard dimensions are used for specific furniture. Universal design is becoming popular. The modern furniture is more visually interesting sometimes, or more like a piece of art rather than an object that fills the space. They are compact and give a home a more open and airy atmosphere. To conclude, in today's lesson, we have been discussing about the major features of traditional, contemporary and modern furniture. This would have given you adequate knowledge on the various styles in furniture. It may help you to identify the styles of furniture so that you may select the required furniture while you are making an attempt to decorate your interiors. The knowledge what you have gained will definitely give you an idea, but practice will help you to succeed in your venture. All the best.